Welcome to the Yogis podcast. Here we talk spirituality, science, and self-improvement, all in the purpose of helping you transcend your normie self. My name is Joselo Aguirre, and I play the role of a love doctor on the internet. Today I had a conversation with Dr. Robert Glover, a speaker, coach, therapist, an educator who is a relationship expert with over 40 fucking years of professional experience, bro. Dr. Glover is the author of the banger book, No More Mr. Nice Guy, and the freaking amazing book, Dating Essentials for Men. And he also recently released Dating Essentials for Men, Frequently Asked Questions. Now, I have personally read both of these books, Dating Essentials for Men and No More Mr. Nice Guy, and they have completely changed my life. And I recommended these books to my best friends too, and it changed their lives too. Dr. Glover has helped thousands of men worldwide change their lives in relationships, career, sex, dating, you can name it, masculinity. And I'm one of those guys. My best friends are one of those guys. And hopefully after this podcast, you are one of those guys too. In today's conversation, we talked about why you're scared to talk to girls, how to confront that fear using testing interest, and how to stay masculine and stay on purpose during a long-term relationship, and to avoid going through the same mistake most men do, which they get lazy, they get comfortable in a relationship. It was such an amazing conversation. It was such a dope podcast. I'm so excited for you to hear it. So I hope you enjoy it. I'm done rambling. Go and enjoy it.
To start off this conversation, I wanted to first, for the people that don't know who you are, which I'm sad for them, could you just give us a brief introduction of who's Robert? Who's this Mr. Robert Glover guy?
Who's this Mr. Dr. Robert Glover guy? All right. Probably most people know me because I wrote a book called No More Mr. Nice Guy. I've written a few other books, Dating Essentials for Men and Dating Essentials for Men, Frequently Asked Questions. And I co-authored another book called The Big Stick that actually just came out on audio yesterday. So we're excited about that. But No More Mr. Nice Guys is, you know, it's for nice guys, for men that are too passively pleasing, trying to make people happy. They end up being frustrated and resentful and think, I'm such a nice guy. How come everybody doesn't like me? Or how come people, you know, still get mad at me? Or how come women don't want to date me? Or how come, you know, all these things of thinking, if I'm just nice, everything should work out okay. And so No More Mr. Nice Guy, contrary to what some people might think, doesn't teach guys how to be not nice. It teaches them how to be authentic. And I talk about being an integrated man where you accept all parts of yourself and you don't hide anything about you. You don't try to become something other than what you are. And you learn to just love yourself as you are. So that's just a little bit about me. That's probably why you and I are talking. So I wrote some books.
Yes, that's how I first discovered you. I listened to No More Mr. Nice Guy while driving last summer, and I listened to it twice. It's a 6-hour long audiobook, and I loved it.
That's a long drive.
I used to do Uber last summer, so I was driving all day, every day. So I just took advantage. Then I read the actual book. Then I read Dating Essentials for Men, and it completely changed the way I viewed the world, my whole paradigm shift, and the way I dated. But I noticed that book was like, I noticed maybe your target audience was just older men, kind of married men. I noticed that. I just felt it, but I still applied a lot of the stuff. So I wanted this conversation to really orientate around talking to like a young man in his 20s.
Sure, sure.
Who could read No More Mr. Nice Guy, Dating Essentials for Men, but doesn't really resonate with it because he doesn't understand. Like, he's not a married man, but he's a young guy and is in college dating and wants to understand this stuff.
Right. No, that makes perfect sense, because when I wrote No More Mr. Nice Guy, it took about 6-7 years to write. And I was married, and I was in my second marriage at that time. And so that was kind of my view of life. And a lot of the stories in No More Mr. Nice Guy are written from the point of view of men in relationship. And then I split with my second wife just about the time No More Mr. Nice Guy was published. And so I became single in my late 40s for the first time in my adult life. So I learned how to date in my 40s and 50s. And so my client started saying, you know, Robert, you're having success dating. You're having success getting women. You're getting laid. You know, what are you doing? And I said, well, I teach us. I said, well, I'm not a dating teacher. I'm not a dating guru, but I am a relationship expert, I guess. My doctorate is in marriage and family therapy. So I've been working with people around relationships, you know, for 40 years. And so in a way, teaching men how to date was just an extension of teaching them how to have good relationships. So, but you're right, because, you know, I was in my 40s and 50s writing those books, but I was working with younger men. And my own son is like 38 years old, but even worse, you and I are talking about a group even younger than that. So each generation I know has their own challenges. Each generation kind of grows up differently, because like a younger generation around your age tended to hang out, I'll use the word gangs or groups, guys and girls, you know, together, just hanging out doing stuff. And so like a lot of guys, younger men would say, well, you know, there's this girl I like and she's in the group I hang out with, you know, should I tell her I like her? Should I date her? Should I take her out? And that's different. My generation didn't just everybody go hang out in a big group and you know, where the girls were kind of the bosses and the guys were just kind of tagging along, you know, hoping maybe one of the girls would like them. It's just a different experience. So I've talked with plenty of men your age. But yeah, what I wrote really did come from a little bit older perspective than that. So ask me anything that you want to know and that you think guys your age would want to know about women, dating, sex, relationships. Let's just dive into that.
Let's dive into like the first challenge I know from a lot of young men and myself is that there's a big fear right now. Like they're afraid. They're just afraid of the opposite sex. And yeah. I'm at the gym with my friends. I love going to the gym. And they tell me, they're like, oh, look at, like, they check out a girl. And I'm like, oh, yeah. Look at her. And then I'm like, oh, yeah, it's a normal conversation. And I'm like, all right, go talk to her then. I give them that challenge.
Yeah.
And everything goes to shit after that. They start, like, not making eye contact with me. They're, like, ignoring me. And then they get very, like, self-conscious. And they don't.
Your friends
do. My friends and, like, people I talk to at the gym, they're just afraid. Yeah. They're so afraid. There's a big fear. Like, they don't want to talk to them at all because there's fears of being called a creep. They think it's being a creep to talk to a girl. They don't want to be caught on social media. There's just a big fear out there right now.
Yeah. Well, there's a lot of stuff in that one question. Okay. So let's kind of peel it apart, because there's a lot of stuff we can really dive into. When when I'm like flying on an airplane or in public or at a party or something like that, and the conversation comes up that, you know, a woman, maybe I'm chatting next to, so, well, what do you do? And well, you know, I tell them I'm an online marketer because I sell stuff on the internet. And I said, but really, I'm, you know, my background's, I'm a marriage and family therapist. Now I work with men primarily, and I teach guys to date. And then they get really interested. They want to know what I teach guys. And it's really interesting when I teach guys, when I tell the women what I teach men about being assertive, about setting the tone and taking the lead, about being bold. The women all kind of like this, going, where can I meet those guys? And women will say, can I come stand out in your parking lot, you know, outside your workshops? Can you put up a website so, you know, I can meet? Because the women are wanting men who will be assertive, who will be strong, who will be confident. And the women, then often they'll ask me, they'll say, can I ask you a question? I go, sure. And they'll say, how come I can like check a guy out? I can look his way. I can smile at him. I can do everything but just walk up to him, you know, and hand him my phone and say, you know, how come men won't react? How come they won't come over and could talk with me? And I go, because you scare them. And they go, why? And they go, because you're scary. And they go, well, we're not scary. And I go, yeah, but you are to men. And then they'll say, okay, well, maybe I'm having a conversation with a guy. And, you know, it's going really well. I touch his arm. I laugh at his jokes. You know, I keep waiting and waiting. And then the guy holds out his hand, shakes my hand, says, nice to meet you. You know, maybe I'll bump into you sometime, and walks away. And they go, how come the guy doesn't ask for my number? And I go, she goes, I'm doing everything. And I go, because he's scared. Why? Because you're scary. So women, of course, don't see themselves as scary. They're just, you know, they're just a mess of insecurities in their own head, and they can't figure out why we'd be afraid of them. I mean, they just think they're a insecure mess. So there's one reason. I think there's just something in that dynamic that a woman you don't know, who might reject you, who might, you know, who knows what, it's the unknown. You don't know what she's going to do, okay? So there's one piece of it. And yeah, another piece is we do live in a world, and, you know, especially for younger men, but a lot of ages now, that's consumed with social media. You don't want to get called a creep, a perv, a stalker. You don't want to be a hashtag Me Too casualty. You don't, you just, and it's understandable because people can put whatever they fucking want on the internet about you. And what can you do? How can you even defend yourself? You know, so guys, I think, are afraid of, you know, both looking foolish, being rejected, but also being called out in some way. Here's another piece, and I don't know if you can relate to this, but this, I find this true for men of all ages, but I think your younger guys might relate to it. When we're boys and you know, we're being raised when we're young, primarily by our mothers, maybe dad's around, maybe dad's not around. But for the majority of boys, most of our contact when we're really young is with mom. And we go through certain stages of wanting to possess our mother, wanting to own our mother, wanting to marry our mother. You know, little boys will say, "Mommy, when I grow up, I'm going to marry you." And I heard another coach say, girls never say that to their dad, but boys say it to their mothers. "I want to marry you." So we go through a developmental phase that's really normal of wanting all of our mother, right? We want her to approve of us, only love us, us only. And it's a stage of development. And it happens a couple, like about 3 and around 5 years old. Now, in the past, years ago, you know, once a boy reached old enough to like get out of the house and help dad with the work, cows or chickens, with the farm, with hunting, with, you know, going back to, you know, tribal times, just getting out and, you know, hunting and gathering, the boy went to be with the men. So he was soon taken away from his mother, you know, 8 years old, 9 years old, 12 years old, whatever. So he kind of broke that bond of mother. But what happens now, there's nothing to break that bond. There's no masculine initiation. There's no fathers, the men, cousins, uncles, grandfathers taking you kind of away from mom. So what happens is young men now, and even my generation, we grow up learning to please women. So when you're a little boy, you want to please your mother because your survival depends on mother, you know, being okay, being happy and being okay with you. So we learn to please mother. We don't want to do anything that might upset mother. Then we get to school. Now, I don't know about when you were in school, but for me, I only had one male teacher from kindergarten until I got to junior high. Now they call it middle school. One. So that meant for me to get from second grade to third grade, I not only had to learn my reading, writing, and arithmetic, but I had to learn how to please a woman, right? Because I had female teachers. So all of that's really pretty normal of us wanting the approval of women so that we can be okay as little boys and as young men. And again, the main problem is there's no men to take us out and teach us how to live in the scary world of the masculine. You know, how to be with women, how to get work done, how to face fears, all those things that masculine initiation does. So that means we grow up to be adolescents, young adults, adult males, and we're still, I call it caught up in the nursery. We're still just kind of avoiding anything that's scary, anything that, you know, we don't know how to do, and we just still keep trying to please women. Now, here's the thing. We have this fear that if we walk up and talk to a woman, gym, wherever, you know, introduce ourselves. Yeah, I'm not a big fan of pickup, like going up and let me do magic tricks for you. Let me do NLP. Let me hypnotize you. I'm just a big fan of, you know, a woman notice you, say, hey, you know, my name's Robert. What's yours? You know, just go from there. If she's interested, the conversation will go. If she's not, it'll just end with that. That's okay. But what our fear is, what if we upset her? What if we lose her approval? What if we get a negative? And remember, we've been trained since little boys. Don't get a negative reaction from a woman, right? We don't want negative reactions from mom. We don't want negative reactions from teachers. So we play it safe. And so that's what your friends are doing. They're playing it safe. What if I go interact with her and I get a negative reaction, whatever that might be? You know, rejection, you know, she tells the, you know, the management at the gym that you're harassing her. She puts it on social media, whatever. You don't know, so you don't risk it. Now, here's where this also shows up. I've talked with a lot of guys that, you know, they're talking to a woman, it's going well, maybe it's a situation where they just met and they're having a good conversation, or maybe it's a situation they've gotten to know each other over time. And, you know, the guy thinks, well, you know, she's nice to me. She talked to me. We spend time together. But they don't do anything to escalate that to the next level. And you know, I've asked men why, you know, they go, well, she put me in the friend zone. I said, no, women don't put us in the friend zone. We put ourselves in the friend zone. Why? Because we're afraid of doing anything that might lower our approval rating with the woman. So if we say, hey, let's go out. Or, you know, if we show some physical affection, if we take our hand and lead her, if we're playful with her, if we, you know, if our sexual agenda is out there in the open rather than repressed. Women know why we talk to them, by the way. They know we talk to them because we want to see them naked. They're not stupid. But they pretend like they don't know it, but they do. So what happens is we have this big fear of what if I do something, anything, and it causes her to reject me, not approve of me, or if she does seem to approve of me, what if I cause her for that to go down? So guys should play it safe. And the problem is being nice, playing it safe, being passive does not turn women on. And women are not naturally aggressive when it comes to relationships. Some girls will be, but naturally they'll send signals. Hey, look at me, notice me, pay attention to me, talk to me. They'll send those signals, but most guys miss them. Or they're afraid to, you know, what if I got it wrong? What if I misread? What if she's really like checking somebody else out, not me? All that kind of stuff. So guys just grow up being passive. I was listening to a voicemail today from a voice message from a client I've been working with for about 6-8 months. And he just turned 42. So, you know, he's younger than me, but older than you, of course. He now has intimate sexual relationships with 5 different women. Even has a girlfriend in there. And all of the women know he's being sexual with other women. And you know, and they're all like falling, they're all in love with him. And they like having sex with him. And they all know he's not monogamous. And he goes, how come I just now learned this in my 40s? How come I didn't know this when I was younger? I mean, I've just listened to that voice message. It's like, you know, nobody taught me if you plant tinfoil in the ground, it's not going to grow carrots. I thought that was kind of a funny analogy. But that's what happens. None of us, when we're young, get taught, you know, hey, if you put tinfoil in the ground, you're not going to grow carrots. If you're passive and avoidant with women, you know, you're not going to get a girlfriend. You're not going to get laid. So what happens is, guys your age, who's teaching you? Other than maybe Andrew Tate, people on the internet, Red Pill, stuff like that. And there's some truth to what these people teach. But most of them, it's kind of like us against them. The women are out to get us, all that kind of stuff. And I mean, do you really want to go get involved with somebody that you think's out to get you? I don't. So anyway, there's a great big long answer to the question of why your friends don't go talk to the women. They don't want to do anything where they might lose a woman's approval because they've been conditioned since infancy to do everything under the sun to make sure that the women in their lives approve of them.
That was a great answer, Robert. That was amazing.
a little bit long, but you know, I think your guys have enough attention span to take that in.
I think they do. To give you a personal story, I'm thinking back to the gym when I was that one of my best friends there from high school. I know him. He's good with the girls. He's had girlfriends and he was attracted to this girl next to me that was working out. He's like, hey, like that girl you were squatting next to, like she was really attractive. And I do immediately like, okay, go and talk to her. He's single now. Like, go and do it. Like, you're attracted to her. Go and put yourself out there. Mm-hmm. And he's like, no. And then he says, I'm going to see if I can get her attention. Like, he was trying to get her attention.
Yeah, which actually like that is female behavior. Females try to get men's attention because they want the man to take action, right? If the guy is trying to get a woman's attention, is forcing her to take action, which is masculine. And so this is one thing I teach men. Masculine does, feminine is done too. This is really good to know in terms of what's called polarity, because for attraction depends on polarity. But if what happens with a lot of men nowadays, they create reverse polarity with women. I'll try to get her attention, which is female, i.e. she'll notice me and come towards me. That's feminine. Rather than, as you say, go talk to her. And I'm with you. I'm a big fan of just saying, hey, my name is, say your name. What's your name? You know, where are you from? You know, you're getting a good workout in. It doesn't have to be magic. It doesn't have to be a great pickup line. It doesn't have to be anything, because if she has any interest whatsoever, she'll show some interest. You don't have to make it happen. It will just begin to unfold if you will just take that first action.
In an earlier podcast I listened to a while ago, I heard you say how you didn't like the red pill. You just didn't resonate with like the way you are. And I love that, because that I resonated with what you were saying, because I didn't like the red pill myself. A lot of like the content that I post, I'm very against red pill, where I'm like, you don't need a pickup line. You don't need to say anything. You don't need a script. You just go up, say your name, give her a compliment, and then let it unfold, as you said.
Let it unfold. Yeah, I spoke at a conference. Oh, this has been about, it must have been before COVID. So it was like 4 years ago at least. And it was basically a red pill pickup conference. And the guy that puts the conference on has really high regard for me and my book. And he said, and he invites me every year. And so I went, and I remember asking, there were probably about 200 guys there. And when I go speak at a conference, I like to hang out in the lobbies in a hotel, whatever. And I just wait out in the lobby because I like it when people come and say, you, Dr. Glover, can I talk to you? You know, I like that. You know, a lot of the other speakers, you never see them. But I thought, well, I'm going to travel across the country and go speak somewhere. I'm going to hang out with the people that paid money to travel across the country to come hear me speak. And so I talked to a lot of guys, and a lot of guys there said, I read your book. I love your book. Thank you. It changed my life. And so I remember when I gave my talk, I began by saying, I asked how many people read my book, and about three quarters of them. And I said, I don't know if No More Mr. Nice Guy is the gateway drug to Red Pill, or Red Pill is the gateway drug to No More Mr. Nice Guy. I said, it doesn't matter. Because there's a lot in Red Pill stuff, like stuff I've read, that, yeah, I agree with it. I don't disagree with the psychology of it. But the two things I don't love about Red Pill, one is, it's kind of this paranoia that the women are out to get us. They're out to just take us for whatever we're worth, and then they're going to move on and get a richer guy. I don't like that. That's a real strong part of it. You know, they're out to get us. So we got to protect her. We got to spin plates. We got to date a bunch of them, but don't let them get close. Don't marry them. Don't, you know, and you know, most of the red pill guys I know that teach red pill are married, which is kind of funny. But the other part I don't like about red pill is it puts men in a hierarchy. Red pill up here, blue pill down here. You know, they call them the average frustrated chumps, or, you know, the beta. I don't like, I'm alpha, you're beta. I don't like doing that to men. You know, we men are brothers, right? We don't need to be acting like I'm so much better than you. You're down there because you don't get it, you know. So I don't like that, all right? Now, is some of the psychology of red pill accurate? Yeah, I think a lot of it is. Does a lot about pickup work? Yeah, a lot. So I was at this conference. It was like a red pill pickup / conference, right? And I just began my talk saying, I don't identify as red pill. I don't identify as pickup, but I do love working with men. So this, you know, let's get busy. Let's start talking. And so, you know, and a lot of these guys are a red pill pickup conference, love my work. I love them. So, you know, I don't get into battles around it, other than there's some things that I don't like, just mainly about us against them or a hierarchy among men. So what I am a big fan of is being your authentic self, not trying to become something or be somebody you're not, not hiding anything about you, and just practice being bold, living life on your terms. And, you know, for young men, that's part of what being a young man is about, is finding out, who am I? What do I like? What do I love? What do I like doing? Where do I want to go in life? And that's just part of being an adolescent and a young adult. It's that exploration of, who am I? How does the world work? How do I fit into the world? So you really got to try a lot of things. Now, in terms of the gym, I'm not a real big fan of just walking up to women at the gym, you know, because I'm thinking, I could be wrong, but I'm thinking they're there to work out. I'm there to work out. It's not a club, right? But what I found, that if a woman wants your attention, it doesn't matter if it's at the gym, you know, the grocery store, you know, it doesn't matter. If a woman wants your attention, She'll try to get your attention because, again, that's the feminine thing to do, send you a signal. She might look your way. You might notice she's looking at you in the mirror at the gym. She might come get on the stair climber right next to you. She might bend over and you get like a boob shot, you know, cleavage shot as her shirt comes open. She may stand and kind of jut a hip near you. These are primate behaviors. This is what you know, chimpanzees and apes do. The females send these physical signals to the males. I'm ready. Come take me. So women will send those signals. And if the woman is sending you a signal, why not start a conversation? If she comes gets on the stair climber next to you, why not just say, hey, how's your day going so far? You know, just say anything. You know, if she's checking you out in the mirrors at the gym, you know, walk over to where she, you know, and pick up a couple of dumbbells, you know, whatever, and just say, you know, how'd your workout going? Just say something. And if she has interest, she'll usually pick the conversation up. You don't have to make it happen. If she has low interest, if you misread it, you know, I'm a big fan. I call it getting to rejection quickly. Find out quickly. You know, is she interested in having a conversation with you or not? And then I'm a fan of being bold. Where at that point, if she showed like some positive attention, like, you know, noticed, smiled, said her name, whatever, you just say, hey, I know you're working out. I'm working out. I got to bounce. But you know what? Give me your number. You know, give me your Instagram, whatever it is. However, is that how guys tend to communicate nowadays on Instagram? Or, you know, my age was, you know, give me your number. You know, put it in my
give
phone.
Give me your number.
But now, how do you do it now?
Now for the youth, it's usually just Instagram. Instagram is like the new Tinder. That's what I discovered in my time.
Yeah, that's what I thought. I'd heard that it was mainly young men and women kind of like, oh, here's my Instagram.
Yeah. So testing interest is one of the things that really like clarified what you're talking about, testing interest. Right. Could you explain that to the young man watching right now? How does he test a girl's interest and help him like get over that? Because they are afraid of getting rejected. So testing interest is like a different mindset for you're not getting rejected. You're just testing it.
It is. And actually, you know, I'm a big fan of getting rejected. Well, I'll say more about that. You know, as I said, when I started dating in my late 40s, you know, I'd not had a lot of, I've been married twice, but you know, I wasn't confident with women, hadn't had a lot of success. And mainly because I was a nice guy back then. I was trying to please them, you know, not do anything that might upset them, hide my sexual agenda from them. Oh, I don't want to have sex with you. I just want to listen to you talk about your problems, that kind of thing. You know, I call that nice guy seduction. Let me do something for you, you know. But no, I don't want to have sex with you. I'm not like those other guys. So of course, you know, I didn't get laid all that much and I didn't get that much, you know, I created no polarity. But by the time I got divorced in my late 40s, you know, I wasn't getting younger, of course. My hair was falling out, turning gray. You know, I was in okay shape. And I started having a lot of success with women. And I thought, you know, what planet have I landed on? But here's what happened for me, is that I really, without consciously doing it at first, I become what I call a social animal. I just started getting out in public a lot. I was living alone. I'd take my laptop. I'd take a book. I'd take the newspaper. I'd go to a coffee shop. I'd eat out a lot at happy hours at a bar. I'd go listen to live music. I took salsa lessons. I just went and was in public a lot. And I just started interacting with people, waitresses, baristas, men, older women, younger women, it didn't matter, everybody. I just started being social. And that's one thing that a lot of men struggle with, and especially a lot of younger men. It's like they don't know how to be social. They know how to be on their phones and they know how to play video games and you know but they don't know how to just be social. It takes practice. So I practiced. I just got in public. And as I started interacting with people and then started having success in meeting women, and I got on online dating as well. I was doing match.com. That was before the swipe right apps on phones. That shows my age and you know, how long ago that was. And when my clients were coming to me for therapy, started saying, Robert, teach us what you're doing. I thought, okay, how do I teach them what I'm just naturally doing? So that's where I came up with the concept of testing for interest. So the way I break it down, it happens in three stages. And my rule of thumb is generally do this everywhere you go with everybody you happen to come in contact with. Now, guys will say, everybody? No, not literally everybody, but a lot. Do it a lot. And in my dating essentials on my podcast, I end them all with get out of the house, expand your route, linger in public, talk to the people you meet, test for interest, walk through open doors. That's kind of my whole philosophy right there. Because if you're sitting at home, you're not going to meet many people. If you go to the same place every day, 7 days a week, you're going to meet the same people. You're not going to get a very expanded route. If you do the same thing, you're going to get the same thing you always got. So kind of expand your social sphere, right? Go more places, be around more people more often. And then as you interact with people, the testing for interest occurs at three levels. And all you're trying to do is ascertain how high is this person's interest in having an ongoing interaction with me. Now, again, I do this with men, women, kids, old people. It just doesn't matter. Just interact. And so level one is just social pleasantries. So three levels. All three levels, you're just checking in. What do I perceive is their interest in having an interaction with me? And you learn to be really good at reading social cues this way. And you do it with everybody. Because what we guys want to do, men will ask me all the time, say, Robert, what do I do when I see a girl I like across the room? I go, what do you mean you see a girl you like? Well, you know, I like her. I go, you don't even know her. How do you know if you like her? Well, you know, she's pretty. Okay, well, that's different, right? You're attracted to her. That's different than you like her, right? You like somebody that you know, right? If you think she's pretty, okay, she's pretty. That's a whole different story. And they go, well, what do I do? And so if you wait until you see somebody you like or that's pretty across a room and think, what do I do now? You probably won't do anything like your friends at the gym. Or if you do something, it'll be pretty clumsy, kind of awkward because you haven't practiced. Most things we get good at practice, whether it's playing an instrument, doing math, programming a computer, working out at the gym. You get good with practice. But a lot of young men don't want to practice their social skills. So this is great practice. So practice with everybody. That way, when you've been used to just interacting with everybody in general, well, even if they're a lot older than you, younger than you, guys, doesn't matter. If you've been practicing, all of a sudden you notice, oh, this woman I was just talking to, she's kind of cute. And, you know, and you start thinking, and I've been talking to her just like I talk to everybody else. And all of a sudden you start noticing you didn't put her up on this pedestal thinking, oh, she's so cute. How do I go talk to her? You're just doing with her what you always do with everybody else. And I started noticing that after a while I thought, you know, I'd walk away after a conversation. I go, you know, she's young. She's hot. We had a good conversation. And 5 years ago, I wouldn't have even talked to her because I would have been afraid of her. And I thought, I didn't even think to be afraid of her because I just did what I always did. Okay, so level one testing. Social pleasantry. It's as simple as, how's your day going so far? That's my favorite one. You know, if I'm in an elevator, if I'm talking to a barista at a coffee shop, a waitress, how's your day going so far? And I almost always ask people their name. Especially waitresses, coffee shop people. Hey, what's your name? And, you know, sometimes they have a name tag on. So, what's your name? You know, kind of gesture, like, show me your name tag. And then remember it. Say their name again. You know, if their name is Liz, if it's Debbie, if it's Jessica, doesn't matter. Jessica, if it's Jim, if it's Bill, doesn't matter. Bill, good to meet you. Say their name and say, how's your day going so far? Again, no magic. It's not pickup. It's just being socially pleasant. You know, if they got shopping bags in their hand, say, hey, been shopping? You know, you're getting an elevator. Here's shopping. Been shopping? Of course they've been shopping. It's obvious. You know, if it's pouring down rain. Yeah, I think it's ever going to quit raining. Doesn't matter. Just say something that's social pleasant. You know, if you're at the gym, you know, and if the woman's next to, you know, a piece of equipment, hey, you mind if I come, you know, jump on this piece of equipment next to you? Or you mind if I come grab this dumbbell? You know, just say something, anything to give them a chance to interact with you. So if they, you know, interact back and they'll go, my name's Jessica. You know, how's your day going so far? You know, then that's what I call high interest. They've engaged with you. If you, you know, ask them, how's their day going so far? They go, fine. Look down at their phone. That's low interest, right? Now you haven't done anything wrong. No harm, no foul. You've actually just made the world a better place by being, you know, a pleasant social person. Okay. So I remember one time I went on a date with a woman. I think it was our second or third date. We were at a restaurant, a P.F. Chang's restaurant in the Seattle area where I lived at the time. And a waitress came and took our order, a young waitress. And I asked her her name. She said her name and took our drink order and went back. And the woman I was on the date with said, "You're a flirt." I said, "What do you mean?" She goes, "Well, you asked the waitress her name." I go, "Yeah." I said, "I do that with everybody." She said, "If that was a guy, you would have asked his name?" I said, "Yeah." I said, "I would have." She goes, "Oh, okay." I mean, I wasn't defending myself, and she wasn't really angry. So anyway, the waitress comes back, and she looks at me. She says, "The people in the back said I need to ask you who you are because you're somebody famous." I go, "Oh, really? They told you that, huh?" So I'm kind of watching the woman, and you know, next to me on my date, going, "Who is this guy I'm on this date with?" And what it was is in that restaurant, I would usually go there on Sunday nights, eat at the bar, watch Monday or Sunday night baseball, Sunday night football, didn't matter. It was P.F. Chang's. I got to know the bartenders, all the people working in the back. So because I was social, this waitress comes out and says, "I hear you're famous." And so that, of course, impressed the woman I was on the date with. But that's just because I was social and everywhere I went. So, okay, so social pleasantry, you're not trying to make anything happen. Just how's your day going so far? You do it with everybody so you get practiced at it. Okay. Level two is where just the conversation begins to connect. Not because you're trying to make, you don't try to make it happen. It will just happen. You ask somebody, "How's your day going so far?" Or, you know, "The game's on a TV, you know, who's winning?" Or, you know, which team are you for? You know, anything, just anything. It's just whatever comes to mind, say it, right? And then a conversation might start up. Maybe you find out you like the same team. Maybe you just start a conversation about the game or the quarterback or this or that. If it's a woman, you know, it could be just about anything. But what happens at level two, there's something that clicks, something that connects. You're not trying to make it happen. It just happens. Now, most level two interactions last all of about 30 seconds, maybe 3 minutes, but then people move on. You know, you go back to eating your dinner, you order, you get your coffee and you leave, you know, whatever. They don't go long, but they just go 30 seconds, 3 minutes, and then boom, you're done. You don't try to make them happen. They just organically happen because you just said, "How's your day going so far?" Okay. Level three testing for interest is where you are actually trying to find out how high is their interest in having an ongoing interaction. So it's kind of like I call it, it's the going for rejection, right? I believe in fail forward, fail fast. Don't walk away from a conversation with a woman thinking, "I should have gotten her number. You know, I should have gotten her Instagram. I wonder if she liked me." You know, don't walk away. I said, don't guess, test. So level three, let's say your buddy walks, you know, up to the girl at the gym. You know, grab something, ask how her workout's going, ask for you, "Hey, can you show me how to do that?" Whatever, it doesn't matter, anything. And the conversation's going pretty good, and she smiles and kind of leans and, you know, shows them a thing or whatever. Then he says, "Hey, you know, I want to go get some coffee with you. You know, give me your Instagram." Level three is where you require something of them. Give me your number. Give me your Instagram. Take their hand and lead them somewhere. We probably won't do that at the gym, but maybe on the dance floor, at a club, whatever. Take their hand, lead them out to dance. Say, "Hey, let's go do this." You give them something that they either, you're going to get a real clear yes or no. You know, so what I would do with my phone, I'd always have my phone with me. And, you know, if I'm sitting at a bar or just sitting, you know, somewhere talking, you know, and the interaction's going good, I'd say, "Hey, give me your number." I would just say, I don't ask. I say, "Give me." I don't say, "Can I have your phone number? Do you want to go out sometime?" I'd say, "Give me your number. I got an idea for connecting with you later this week. I want to see you again. Continue this conversation." My phone's already out, right? And so it's there. And as soon as they give me their number, I key it into my phone right there. And I make sure I had their name. All right, Jessica, got it in. And if they spell their name for you, that's real high interest. Right. So then I would hit the call on my phone right there. I would call their number right there in front of them. And then usually if it's in their purse or in their hand, it'll ring, it'll vibrate, whatever. Never gotten a bogus number. And then I leave them a voice message. I'm still standing in front of them. Right. I go, "Hey, this is Robert. I'm standing right in front of you. I said, I got your number. I'm going to text you. I'm going to get back to you in a couple of days. I got this idea for connecting with you. Just wanted you to know who this number was on your phone. Hang it up. Say, all right, I'll get back to you in a couple of days. And then you leave. So the level three is you require something of them. Like, are they going to give you a number or not? They're going to give you their Instagram or not? Are they going to get up and go do something with you or not? You find out quickly so you don't keep guessing. Oh, I wonder, would she go out with me? I wonder, you know, test, don't guess, and be willing to get to rejection. Avoiding rejection is the worst thing you can do. Get to rejection quickly, so then move on. If she has low interest, move on. No harm, no foul. If she has high interest, you lead where you want to take it from there.
Amazing answer. Thank you so much. Some of the advice that I like to give to them that relates to what you're saying is like, be aggressive. Like in today's day and age, what you're saying is aggressive. I call it aggressive game.
Yeah.
Or just be aggressive in general.
Yeah, I call it being authentic, being assertive, being bold, being confident. One of the things you maybe heard me say this or read it. I tell guys, if you interact with anybody, but let's say you interact with a woman or you just live your life with confidence, you will trigger the exact same brain chemicals in her brain that you would experience if she lifted her shirt and showed you her tips, right? It's evolution. You don't have to think, oh, I like that. You get a hit, right? And the women experience the same. I often say a guy who's comfortable in his own skin, knows where he's going, and looks like he's having a good time going there, is highly attractive to the feminine. And I'll say that I just booked an interview earlier today with a female dating coach. And you know, whenever I say that to the female dating coaches, they all go, exactly. Women are drawn to that guy who looks comfortable in his own skin. That doesn't mean we got our shit together. Doesn't mean we never have anxiety. We never have fear. But we're living life on our terms. We like ourselves. We're not walking around thinking, oh, I'm too short. I'm not handsome enough. I don't have enough money. What girls would like me? I'm not good enough. If you're walking around thinking that kind of stuff, it will communicate through your body and your action. That doesn't mean you have to go to the other extreme and go, yeah, I'm so this, I'm so that. But just live your life on your terms. Get comfortable in your own skin. Learn to like yourself. And that's highly attractive. And all of a sudden you start noticing, whoa, women all around me are smiling. Women all around me are giving me numbers. I mean, when I became single in my 40s, women would give me numbers. They were getting naked on first dates without me even saying anything. I'm going, really, what's happening here? They liked the fact that I was competent. I didn't need their approval. I wasn't hesitant. I wasn't passive. I wasn't trying to be nice to get them to like me. I was just, hey, let's go do this. And they go, oh, I like that. He just said, let's go do it. And then they want to do it. So I found that really positive. So whatever we call it, you know, whether it's being assertive, being aggressive, being bold, being confident, the feminine responds well to that. It makes them feel secure. It makes them feel like, yeah, I want to be close to that. Being anxious, anxiety is contagious. If you're anxious around women, they'll feel it. And that makes them feel bad. You think that they're going to want to hang around you if you're anxiety and they feel it in their body? No, it's not because they dislike you. They just don't like how they feel in their body when you're around. And they might not even know why. They just know when you come around, they get this weird feeling, right? What they'd rather have is that tingle, you know, like down there, rather than that, why do I feel that when he comes around? But confidence gives them that tingle down there. Anxiety gives them that kind of feeling. So this just takes practice. Just takes practice. Being that social animal that just does this everywhere you go. And then when you just happen to be next to some woman who's looking at you and smiling, you say, how's your day going so far? You're not even thinking about it. It's just instinct. It's reflex. It's natural. And all of a sudden, you look confident, right? You might not even feel that confident. But because you're doing what you practiced 100 times with people that you didn't care, you know, if they went out with you or not. Maybe you didn't want them to go out, but you just interacted with them to get practice.
Thank you. It's a little bit loud in the background. I'm sorry for that. But I have a deep personal question for my own kind of relationship journey.
Let's do it.
So I'm sorry for the background, but
That's all right. I got a pit bull behind me, and whenever anybody comes to the front gate or does anything, she gets. You might could see her on the floor over there.
He was moving the rug a little bit. It was funny.
Yeah, that's Nala. That's she's my sweetheart. But yeah, she'll make noise too sometimes.
Are we going to be meeting her in the retreat?
Oh yeah, when you come down here, you'll meet her. Nala is feminine, and she loves masculine energy. So, for example, we meet in this room right here. Be like eight guys. She will, every time we come in here, she'll be in here and she'll kind of take turns, go laying down at different guys' feet or getting different guys to scratch her neck. When we go outside to eat, you know, she'll come out and just lay on the patio, just wherever we are. When we pose to get a picture taken, she'll come sit in the front of us to get her picture taken with us. She loves being around the guys. She's in a good example of what I teach to men. If you're confident, feel good in your own skin, it attracts the feminine. And when all the guys leave after a weekend, she's depressed for 2 or 3 days because all that masculine energy leaves. So yeah, you'll get to meet Nala.
That's amazing. So I went on my dating journey and I eventually, of course, got to the point where I attracted a girl that I chose to be my girlfriend. Okay. And now I'm at a point where I want very hard. I'm trying to keep the polarization. I want to keep her in the feminine. I want to keep myself in the masculine. And that's something that it's, of course, not dating, but now we're getting into relationships. How have you experienced in your two marriages? And I believe you're still married now with.
I'm on my third marriage.
Third marriage right now. Yeah.
You'll get to meet Lupita as well. You get to meet my wife.
Yeah. Awesome.
Do you speak Spanish?
Sí.
¿Hablas español? Okay. Well, you can chat with Lupita because she doesn't speak much English.
Perfect. How does one, like, how have you in your own journey kept your self-improvement journey, kept your masculine, your energy strong while still like spending time with the feminine? Because in the way the spirit man says, if you spend too much time with the feminine, that makes you feminine yourself or you start getting into your own feminine.
Yeah. And I think that's true. You know, and I like David Deida's work and Way of the Superior Man. And that's where I first really learned about polarity. Okay. All right. So here's the deal. We're never going to get this right or get it perfect. That's okay. The goal is just be aware, just be conscious that our feminine partner doesn't need to be in her feminine all the time. We don't need to be in our masculine all the time. We all have a masculine and feminine side. But when it comes to relationship, more often than not, your girlfriend is probably going to like it that you create the masculine pole so she can be in the feminine pole. Now, if you'll do that as the default masculine, you can switch that back and forth. My wife is very strong. She grew up 8 out of 10 kids in poverty in Guadalajara, Mexico. I grew up, you know, in the suburbs of Seattle, very white bread, surrounded by Boeing engineers families. So, you know, she had to fight since she was little. You know, she's been messed with by everybody in her life. No, I've had 2 fights in my life, you know. So she's tough. She's strong. She's a gym rat. She goes to the gym 2 hours every day, right? And she can get shit done. She likes to fight. I tease her about that all the time. You like to fight. And she goes, no, I don't. Yeah, you do. You like to fight. So she's strong. And my tendency is I've got a strong feminine side. You know, I like to, you know, my clothes. I like to feel good. I like to be comfortable. I like, you know, I got a strong feminine. I like to be liked. You know, it's all feminine, right? So I have to be conscious of being in my masculine because she is such a masculine creature. And a lot of women nowadays are. A lot of girls your age, they've grown up kicking ass. You know, they're playing soccer and, you know, rugby and this and that, you know, and they're taught in schools, go get a career, you know, go be an achiever. They're taught to be masculine, right? And the boys are, sit still, be quiet, you know, put you on Ritalin, you know, don't be aggressive, don't spit, don't yell, don't swear, don't hit people, don't make, so we're taught, you know, be passive, be more feminine, right? So then we get in relationship and we think, well, she wants to, you know, be in charge and kick ass and get shit done because, you know, but they may be doing that in this part of their life, but in the part of their life with you, they don't necessarily want to be making all the decisions and being in charge. Now, they don't want you to control them, but they do want you to show up with a plan. They do want you to have your own passion in life. They do want you to have your own guy friends. Now, some of them, they make it a little insecure and they go, oh, are you going to hang out with your friends? Are you checking out girls? You know, and probably probably every woman I've been with in long-term relationship at some point went on the attack of my guy friends. Oh, do you have to hang out with him? He's a drunk. He's a womanizer. He just uses whatever it was. But don't let them, you know, pull you out, because then you let them down. If all of a sudden you quit hanging out with your guy friends because they think he's a drunk or this or that, all of a sudden you gave up all the power to the woman, and then she's going, I'm not even interested in him anymore. Why? Because we let them take control and dominate. So my wife, Lupita, like I said, she can out-squat me in the gym. I mean, she's just strong. And she can beat the hell out of me. She's done Muay Thai and kickboxing. And she grew up, like I said, in a tough world. And she can get shit done like nobody's business around the house and getting the cars fixed and all that stuff. But she says, you know, I like it when you tell me no. I like it when you have a plan. I like it when you're in charge. And she likes it that I'm making a difference in the world. You know, I don't think she even knows everything that I do with my work, but she does know when guys come to the house for a workshop and they're all talking to her in the kitchen and waving and telling her, your husband's amazing. Your husband's book changed my life. She's going, that's my husband. You know, he's a big man. He's made a difference in the world. She likes that. Right? She likes knowing that her man is the man that other men look up to. Right? She likes that a lot. And so keeping the polarity, we'll go into a restaurant. You know, I live here in Puerto Vallarta, and I learned Spanish in my 50s and 60s because Lupita doesn't speak English, and my stepkids don't speak English. They do a little bit. I make them speak English at the dinner table. So we'll walk into a restaurant, and the waiters will ask her in Spanish, should I give him a menu in English? And she'll say, no, he's in Mexico. He can order in Spanish. And then I said, give her and the kids the menu in English. They need to practice their English. Then they give Lupita a menu. She says, no, he'll order for me. He's my boss. And then I joke that, yeah, I get to be the boss when she says I can. You know, we joke about it. But she likes it that I'll just say, hey, you know, let's get this and this. And I go, you like that, don't you? Yeah, okay, we're going to get this. Where I just make the decisions. She can make all the decisions. It was always funny is when I order in Spanish to the waiters, they, you know, my Spanish is decent enough to order, and they'll write it down. Then they'll look at her and read it back, like to make sure, did I get this all right? You know, because she's, of course, the native Spanish speaker. And so, but she says, I love it when you tell me no. I love it when you order. I taught her like I've taught every woman in my life, wait for me. I'll open your door, get in the car, out of the car, going through buildings. That is such a great way to create that polarity is you train them, wait for me. I open the door. And then every now and then, if she hops out of the vehicle, I go, what? The rules change? Get back in. And, you know, I'll bump her back in, close the door, open it again, hold my hand out and say, you can get out now. I had to train my mother to do that, train my granddaughter to do it. I've trained every woman in my life. My stepdaughter, everybody, to where now my stepson, he's 18. If he's anywhere in the vehicle with his mother, he's opening her door. He's opening the gate. He's open. So, you know, I've trained him to do that. Not to be a passive gentleman. I mean, it is a gentleman way of being, but to set the tone. So the woman feels provided for, protected for, feels safe. Because the feminine wants to feel safe. When the feminine feels safe, she opens. And then we kind of like them to be open, right? We don't want them closed. So doing those little things to set the tone. And, you know, instead of saying, do you want to go out tonight? Say, hey, I got an idea for tonight. Instead of saying, what do you want for dinner? You know, you say, hey, you know, how about we get, you know, some church's fried chicken? I don't know, whatever. And then if she said, well, I don't really want chicken. All right, what do you want? You know, you can have a conversation, but start the conversation. Lead with an idea. You know, if you want to watch TV tonight, no. Say, hey, there's a show I don't want to watch. You want to watch such and such? And then if she says, well, I was wanting to watch this. Okay, great. Let's watch this. Let's watch that. You know, you can work it out between you, but you set the tone and lead. Don't burden her with that. They don't like that. They'll make all the decisions if you don't. But it kills the polarity. They're in their masculine. They're now leading. You're following. And they're not very open. Right? So you don't have to lead or be masculine all the time. But I think that does need to be a default position that you easily take so that she can polarize into her feminine. Again, if she's out in the world, if she has a job, if she's in school, if she's getting anything done, that's all masculine. She wants to come home and melt into her feminine with somebody else who will set the tone and lead and make a few decisions so she doesn't feel burdened by that. Now, again, every woman's different in how that interaction goes, but lead and let her follow. And I always say that a woman can't follow where a man doesn't lead. So you'll lead. Now, lead isn't being in control, like I said. It's just you say, hey, let's do this. Or I was thinking about this. Or, you know, I think this would be a great idea. Or, you know, here's what's on my mind. And see if she follows. And if she says, well, I was kind of wanting this, you can go. That works. Let's do blah, blah, blah to do that, right? You're still leading. So, and then it's okay if you switch. It's okay if she says, hey, I got this plan. Let's go do this. You say, okay, you lead the way. I'm with you. You can switch it. But then when you get to the car, even if my wife's driving, for example, I'll sit and she can come open my door and let me out. She likes doing that, actually. So we'll switch those roles. But she knows that we're always going to switch back to where I lead and she follows.
Thank you so much for that. I got so much out of that myself where I feel like I need to go open my mom's door right now. She just got home from the grocery store, but that's
you can tell her, Mom, for now on, if we're riding in a car together, if we can say, Mom, wait. When I told my mother that the first time, my father had already passed away. And she, you know, I said, wait for me, Mom. I'm going to come open your door. She was right in the passenger seat. I'm driving. And she said, if I waited for your father to open my door, I'd still be waiting. And I go, wait, I'll come open the door. You know, now because she's had a stroke, I have to put her seatbelt on for her as well. But, you know, it's what you do. You know, it's your mother. So anyway, yeah, lead with your mother. She'll like it. She'll like having that powerful gentleman in her life.
Yeah, I've noticed that masculine, like the one that you learned from David Data, the one I learned from your book too, like girls like that. Girls nowadays, like girls, women like that in general, feminine women, of course.
Yeah, they and let's enjoy say, it. Let's we have to say in general, maybe not all of them do. And they're going to test it sometimes. You can think, well, they test it. And you're going to think, well, maybe she didn't like it. But no, they're just testing it to see, can they count on it? Can they depend on that kind of leadership that you bring?
Is it valid?
Yeah, is it valid? Can I trust is a key thing. Can I trust it? Because like if you say, wait, I'm going to open your door and you open it once and then you don't do it the next time, they'll go, nope, can't trust them. Or, you know, like with my wife, here's a trust issue. You know, I've got a gym in my house because, again, she's a gym rat. So I've got, you know, Olympic weights, spin cycle, punching bag, dumbbells, everything you need to get a good workout in. And she's in there every day. She works out there and then goes to the gym. And I say, yeah, I got to work out today. And then I don't do it, right? That breaches trust because she knows, I know I need to be in the gym. I need to be working out. I need to get a sweat on. And when I don't do it, she goes, oh, he said he's going to do it. And he didn't. You know, he said he'd open my door, but he didn't. We don't think that is a lie, but for the feminine, that's a breach of trust because they know we either committed to it and didn't follow through, or we know we should be doing it, but we get busy and distracted and don't. So every time I don't get to the gym, I know it hurts her a little bit because she goes, I want my man to follow through on what he knows is good for him and what he said he's going to do. So that's a good way to kind of keep us in line is going, I don't want to breach my woman's trust.
Thank you. Thank you. I want to be respectful of your time. I know you have a call at 2:00.
Give me one second because I did ask them, let me check messages real quick. If yeah, I could bump that a little bit. So let me just see if I've heard back from them.
Perfect. Thank you.
Yes, they can bump it a little bit. So why don't we just take, you know, couple more minutes. You've got another question or two. So I have just a little bit more time.
Perfect. Thank you so much. Kind of to go on with what we were talking about, that trust, how would you say you could like first confirm that trust and then kind of maintain it for the long run? The trust with the feminine.
You know, I did a radio interview to answer your question. I'll give an illustration, then come back to the question. I did a radio interview. This is 15 years ago, probably. And it was two women. And I went to the radio station to do it. It's two women that had a show mainly directed at women. And a mutual friend had introduced me to them. She was a dating coach, a mutual friend. So I go on this show. And the women were probably about my age. I was probably in my late probably say us 50. And so we're on a commercial break. And I said something about, I tell the guys, and I kind of toned it down when I told them. But what I tell men, if you fuck with a woman's trust, you fuck with her lust. Right? But I told the women, I tell guys, if you mess with a woman's trust, you mess with her lust. And one of the women said, oh, you need to say that when we go back on the air. I said, I can say that on the radio? Yeah, yeah. So we came back, had that conversation about if you mess with a woman's trust, you're going to mess with her lust. She's going to close, right? You want them open, you know, emotionally open, so that they're physically open to you, to be penetrated by you physically, you know, your hands, your mouth, you know, all your body parts. They want to be opened by you, right? But if they don't trust you, they will close because they have to. They have to protect themselves because they're being vulnerable, right? So I talked about that with this woman, these two women on the radio show. I don't know, 2-3 years later, I was in a coffee shop and the mutual friend was with one of those women, the female dating coach. And she said, hey, Robert. And the other woman said, do you remember me? And I said, yeah, I did the radio show with you. She said, I got to tell you something. You know, when you said that thing about messing with women's trust, you mess with their lust. She goes, I was like 50 and I'd never even thought about that. She said, I had to go home and tell my husband that. And so that's how strong that is. So we mess with a woman's trust in so many different ways. We mess with it by lying to them. We mess with it by hiding our true intentions or agenda from them. Because, like, for example, if you're talking with a girl and you like her and, you know, and you're talking to her because you like her enough that hopefully she'll take her clothes off, you know, at someday. But you try to pretend like that's not why you're talking to her. You know, you're talking, oh, because I want to listen to you talk about your problems. Well, I want to hear about your cats. Yeah, tell me all about your cats. You know, oh, tell me all about your girlfriend, how she hurt your feeling. Oh, you need help paying your car payment? Sure. See, we've hidden our whole sexual agenda, but we're, okay, that's a lie. You know, to listen to them talk about their problems, you know, their dumb cat stories that you don't care about, their stories about their girlfriends that you don't even know. And you're listening to all that because you're hoping at some point she'll take her clothes off, but you're hiding the fact that that's a lie. And you know what? They know it's a lie. Because like I said earlier, they know why we talk to them. We talk to them because we want to see them naked. They know that. They're not stupid. Okay. So if we hide it, it's a lie. If we say we're going to do something and don't do it, that's a breach of trust. You know, we tell them we're going somewhere, but we go someplace different. That doesn't mean you got to check in with them like you're their mother, but you shouldn't be telling something that you know is not going to be the truth, right? Well, I'm going to be hanging out with this guy, but you're really doing that thing. Yeah, you do that very many times to a woman. Some women, because they're wounded, they've been abandoned, they've been lied to, they've been cheated on, usually begins with daddy not being dependable. Some women are actually attracted to the men they can't trust, but that's actually an unhealthy small minority. Healthy women want to trust a man. In order to open to a man, they've got to trust him. So we can bruise your trust in so many ways. And like I said, even just me saying, you know, I'm going to go to the gym today. You know, like my wife might be out and I send her a text. Oh, I'm going to go get my sweat on. I'm going to go sweat. And then she gets home. She goes, You go to the gym. Like I said, the gym's just 10 feet from my office, right? I go out one door, walk in the other, right? And you're this, no, I had to get this thing done. And you know, she's not mad at me. You know, she doesn't think I'm a bad person. She doesn't probably think, oh, he told me a lie. She's going, yeah, that's the same old thing. He says he's going to go in the gym, but he ends up doing that other thing on his computer. And then she wonders, what am I doing on my computer? Now, it's not because she actually thinks I'm doing something on my computer I shouldn't. I've breached her trust. And so now she doesn't know what she can believe and what she can trust about me. If she doesn't trust that I say I'm going to go to the gym when I say I will, her mind will go, what else can't I trust? And I promise you, they will think up all kinds of stuff. Well, maybe I can't trust that. Or maybe that woman at work, maybe he really is, does like her. Or maybe that, you know, he's looking at social media. Maybe he really does that. Once you breach that trust, they got to think up the worst possible things that maybe they don't know so that they're prepared for when it happens. You don't want them going there, right? Now, are we going to be perfect? No, we're going to mess it up. She's going to mess it up. We're going to mess it up. That's okay. But I would say the most powerful thing to do is that going back to like setting the tone and leading, like I talked about, it's not control, is saying, I'm going to open your door, and then opening her door every time. When you say you're going somewhere, that's where you're going. If plans change, send a message, change a plan, going to do XYZ. Let her know. I mean, not that you're checking in, but you know, don't later on we said, did you go do that? No, we did that. Now you said you're going to do that. Well, we changed. No, you lied to me. All right. You hear that, right? You lied. No, I didn't. We changed plan. No, you lied to me. You said you were going there. Right. So just say, hey, going to do XYZ. Just, you know, where there's never a situation that you have to defend yourself in any way. You don't want to be defending yourself to your girlfriend, to your woman. And so be a what you see is what you get kind of guy. Now, don't let her control your life. Don't let her take charge and not let you see your friends. Don't let her say to you, you can't go there because I don't want you to. Say, no, I'm going there, but you just do need to know I'm there. The other thing is don't hold back your feelings and thoughts. You know, so often we don't want to rock the boat. So, well, I don't want to fight over this. Well, I don't want to. Yeah, that's too much hassle to tell her that. If you have the impulse to not tell her, tell her. And you can even tell her. I did this with my second wife. Because if anything I told her, if she'd get upset about it, I'd either not tell her anything or make up a story. Right. So when I started working on my nice guy issues, I'd come home and I go, I need to tell you something. I was going to tell you a lie. Here's the lie I was going to tell you. The lie I was going to tell you is the reason I'm late coming home from work is that there's, you know, this accident and heavy traffic and the stoplight. And I go, the truth is, when I told you I'd be home at 5 o'clock, I knew I wouldn't be leaving till after five, but I said it because I didn't want you to be upset at me. And the truth was, I never intended to be home at five. And funny thing is, she never got mad at the truth. But when I didn't tell her the truth, yeah. So if you notice you wanting to say something, but you're holding it back, that's a lie. Think about that. That's a lie. If you have something you want, maybe it's even affection. Maybe you want to tell her you love her, but you hold it back. Or maybe, you know, you want to say, hey, take your clothes off and get in my bed, but you hold it back. Anything you hold back is a lie. It's healthier and more congruent and more authentic to say, hey, take your clothes off and get in my bed. Or say, you know what I was thinking? Oh, what were you thinking? I wanted to see you naked right now. You know, don't hold it back because it's a lie. And they know it when we're not, you know, I give the example. You're driving down the road. Maybe your woman's in the seat next to you in your car. You're driving and you got gas. And you go, oh, this could be bad. This could be terrible. I can't fart. I can't let it go. And you're driving, trying to hold it in. She knows something. She doesn't know what. She knows you're holding back. She doesn't know what it is. She's thinking, what happened? What changed? What's holding back? He wasn't like that 2 minutes ago. Oh, I know what it was. It was that girl on the corner back there with her boobs hanging out. He's thinking about fucking her. Blah, 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 blah. That's what your woman's over there thinking. Why? Not because you lied to her, but you held something back. You held back that you got gas. And she's imagining the worst. You're thinking about that chick back there on the corner with her boobs hanging out. And you're just trying to be nice by not farting and, you know, killing her. You know, it'd be more honest to say, hey, baby, roll your window down. I got a fart. You know, that's truthful, right? And you know, and she's not going to leave you because you farted. She might leave you because she thinks you keep checking out women that you're not even checking out. You didn't even see the girl with the boobs. And then she goes, you were thinking about that woman with her boobs hanging out. You go, which woman? Why? Why didn't you point her out? You know, yeah, I'm just trying not to fart. So anything we hold back is a lie to the feminine. And so anything that you open and reveal, even if they don't like the truth, I've said for a long time, women can handle a difficult truth. They can even handle your farts. They just can't handle being lied to. So hopefully that answers your question. And I promise you, relationships never get boring if you always tell the truth. They never get boring. Now, you know, you guys may decide you don't like being with each other, but it'll never get boring. So don't hold back the truth. Let her know everything that there is to know.
That's a great answer. It really resonates exactly with that, what I lived yesterday. My birthday was actually yesterday.
Feliz cumpleaños.
Muchas gracias. So I celebrated my birthday with my girlfriend and my friends. One of my friends gave me a present and she was actually very emotionally bothered about it. And this is our first problem in our relationship. We've only been together for 2 months.
Okay.
So everything that I've been learning from the Way of the Superior Man, your book, I was like, I'm ready to apply this. Like, I want to handle this emotional, and I want to open her. I was thinking about it. I want to open her. I want to keep her open. I was trying to apply everything, and it was just a little scary at first, seeing like the dark side of the feminine and her like emotionals. It
Oh,
was
it can be dark. It can be dark.
a little scary, but I was like, no, I have to like keep her open. And then I was like, I'm not gonna lie about anything. I'm not scared about this. I don't want to be scared. I just want to be here, and I'm like, stay strong here for her during this time.
Congratulations. Congratulations.
Perfect. Thank you so much. For all the guys that kind of love you now, I hope they do, because I do even more.
I hope they all love me.
We do. Where could we find you? Where could we find you on the internet? And what are you currently working on? I know you're writing your books. Are you still going on your goal for 10 books in 10 years?
You know what? I've been thinking about that quite a bit lately, and because I've got a whiteboard right over here, it says 10 books in 10 years in 2028. I've written three since I made that commitment back in 2018. So I thought that's seven more to go in the next 5 years, 4 years. And whether I make it or not isn't the real thing. It was meant to just push me forward. The biggest thing I've got going is this Integration
Okay.
Nation. That launched back in July 2023. It's a worldwide men's membership program. We've got I'm on a call every Thursday, 90-minute call that members can be on. We've got seven tribe calls every week, so they get in smaller groups with my coaches. Just all kinds of just great stuff. So I launched this. This takes up most of my time and energy. So guys can either find me at integrationnation.net, drglover.com, that's drglover.com. And of course on Amazon, books, No More Mr. Nice Guy, Dating Essentials for Men, Dating Essentials for Men FAQ, and then the most recent one, The Big Stick. And The Big Stick's just, I co-wrote it with one of my coaches, and it's kind of an overview of everything I've taught for the last 30 years. Good book, good book. So yeah, drglover.com, integrationnation.net is the two places I'd say go look for me.
Perfect. Thank you so much. I'm going to be going to look for you still there.
I know you're going to
Thank
come
you.
look for me. I'm looking forward to you coming
Yeah.
down to Puerto Vallarta for a TPI workshop coming up, and looking forward to getting to know you better. And you're going to have a
Course.
good time. You're going to have a good time.
I'm really excited. I'm really just to get my mask. I always tell that to my guy friends, like, let's go get our masculine up. Let's go for a hike. Let's go to the gym. Let's get our masculine up and our
I
energy
love
up.
it. I love
It's a
it.
beautiful thing. Well, thank you so much for the call.
Marcelo, mucho gusto. Looking forward to meeting you down here in Puerto Vallarta. And yeah, I love being able to talk to, a younger audience because I you guys are the future. I want you guys to be leading this world because you're authentic, you're integrated, you're honest, you're powerful, you're confident. So anything I can do, to help your generation of men, change and shift the direction our world is going. Yeah, I'm all in favor. So thank you for inviting me on your show.
Thank you so much. I know all the young guys are going to appreciate this. All my friends are going to appreciate this, and mostly, of course, my YouTube audience, but I appreciate it the most. Like, I have so many things to apply and so many things just to change my own trajectory of my own journey too.
All right, I'm glad to hear that. So
Thank
look forward
you.
to seeing you in a few months, and let me know when this goes live on YouTube, and I'll spread the word.
Thank you so much. I'll keep in touch with you. I'll see you next month.
All right, take care.
You too. Thank you, Robert.